Dear friends, because of COVID-19 problem which is created by coronavirus throughout the world, most of the syllabus of BSc Part 1st Botany is completed by botany faculty members, but some aspects of botany which are remain to teach during our classroom teaching. So in order to teach the remaining portion of botany, our college has started the facility of e-learning program. So as a part of this e-learning program, we are going to understood or learn some aspects which are remain to teach in our classroom teaching. In BSc Part 1st, paper number 3rd, topic which is remain to teach during our classroom teaching from plant ecology, ecological factors and adaptations. So this topic includes introduction of this topic, definition of the term ecology, scope of ecology in relation to other branches of this science. So as far as introduction of this topic is concerned, ecology is very important branch of life science which deals with the study of interrelationship between organisms and their environment. So the organisms which are living in different types of habitats, organisms includes different types of plants, different types of animals, and they shows different types of relationships with their surrounding or environment. So this branch of botany or life science is practically also having many importances. So whole world is suffering from many problems of pollution, etc., etc. So for giving the solutions for this problem, this branch of life science ecology gives some solutions. That's why the ecological study is very important in the students of life science. So as far as definition of this term ecology is concerned, different ecologists propose different definitions. So simplest definition of this term ecology is, we can define this term ecology. Ecology can be defined as, it is the study of organisms in relation to their habitats, in relation to their habitats. Then we shall discuss the scope of this branch ecology in relation to other branches of science. So as far as scope of this ecology is concerned, the ecology branch shows relationship to other branches of science, for example agriculture, for example botany, zoology, microbiology, chemistry, physics, meteorology, geology and pedology, mathematics and statistics, toxicology and economics and sociology. So knowledge from all these subjects is also essential for the study of this branch, commonly called as ecology. So in this our topic, ecological factors, our syllabus includes only two basic aspects of ecological topic, ecology topic, adaptive factors and climatic factors. So under the topic ecological factors, the first article sub point is adaptive factors. This adaptive factor sub article includes the soil. Under the soil, we are going to discuss origin and formation of soil, composition of soil and soil profile. So these are the sub articles under the heading of adaptive factors. So one by one we are going to discuss the introduction of this topic, soil or adaptive factors, then definition, then formation of soil, then types of withering which is responsible for formation of soil, types of withering and pedogenesis. These are the two things which are responsible for formation of soil, and lastly withering of crops which takes place due to different reasons. So one by one we are going to discuss. So as far as soil is concerned, soil is the important medium for the growth and development of plants as well as some other organisms also. So soil provides raw material like water and nutrients for the growth of plant as well as development of the plant. So soil also provides the shelter for the microorganisms. So plant take the nutrients and water from the basically from the soil. So study of the soil is commonly called as pedagogy. So this soil science or pedagogy includes it's how this soil is originated, that means origin of soil and formation of soil, then composition of soil and soil profile. So as far as origin and formation of soil is concerned, soil is originated from the rocks, that means disintegration of rocks takes place due to different reasons, and finally these rocks are converted into fine particles commonly called as minerals. So major component of the soil is the mineral matter. So as far as the introduction of this topic is concerned, I have already discussed what is meaning of soil, definition of soil, what is the importance of soil. Then we are going to discuss about the remaining points like definition. So what is the definition, scientific definition of the soil? So we can define the soil. Soil is the outermost crust of earth, which is having mineral matter, in which organic matter is mixed, in which plants are growing and animals are living. So this is the very simplest definition of this soil. Then we are going to discuss formation of soil. So as far as formation of soil is concerned, there are two stages in the formation of soil. The first stage in the soil formation is the withering of rocks. Different types of rocks are available in nature. So these rocks are disintegrated by the different disintegrating agents, and finally due to withering of rocks, minerals are formed. The second step in the formation of soil is the pedogenesis. It is also known as soil development. It is also known as soil formation. That means withering of rocks and pedogenesis, these are the two important steps in the formation of soil. So withering of rocks, as far as withering of rocks is concerned, the withering of rocks takes place by three main reasons. That means three basic necessities are essential, or three basic points are essential or responsible for withering of rocks. For example, physical withering of rocks. So physical withering of rocks takes place due to these three components or three factors. For example, atmospheric temperature. Due to fluctuation in the atmospheric temperature, withering of rocks takes place or disintegration of rock takes place. The second factor is water. Either it may be rainwater or moisture in the environment. It is also responsible for somewhat disintegration or abrasion. The term which is used for disintegration of rock by the water or rainwater is commonly called as abrasion. So water and wind. So this wind velocity is also responsible for abrasion of soil. That means as far as physical withering of rock is concerned, this temperature, water and wind, these three factors are responsible for degradation or disintegration of the soil. Then another type of withering which takes place due to chemical means. The chemical withering generally takes place due to organic acids, carbonic acids. So these organic acids and carbonic acids, they are generally produced by the different organisms. These are responsible for disintegration of rocks or breaking the rock pieces into smaller pieces. That means these carbonic acids and organic acids plays important role in the withering process. So many chemical reactions are going on due to different types of chemicals which are produced by the organisms which are responsible for disintegration of rocks. So mostly oxidation, reduction, chelation. So many such kinds of processes are going on in the nature which are responsible for chemical withering of the rocks. Then final withering process, which takes place due to the biological agents, it is commonly called as biological withering process. So biological withering process takes place due to the effect of or impact of animals, plants and microorganisms. So basically animals, mostly most important role of human being in the cutting of rocks, rock pieces. Huge rocks are cut by the human being for different purposes, for construction purposes as well as various purposes, for making dam, for making roads. Wooden pieces of the rocks are cut by the human being. So it is also responsible for breaking the rocks into small pieces. So human beings or animals, then plants. So mostly higher plants as well as lower plants, both are responsible for disintegration of rocks. As far as higher plants are concerned, due to the growth or root system of higher plants in the crevices of the rocks, they are responsible for cracking the rocks into small pieces. As well as the small plants like lichens, fungi, bryophytes, they are also responsible in some extent for the disintegration of rocks. That means the lichens are responsible for secretion of some chemical substances, and these chemical substances secreted by the small plants like lichens, they are secreting chemical substances which are responsible for disintegration of rocks. That means this biological withering process is mostly carried out by animals, plants and microorganisms. Then second step in the soil formation is commonly called as pedogenesis. It is also known as soil formation or soil development. So this pedogenesis process includes so many steps. So actual meaning of pedogenesis is mixing the mineral matter with organic matter. That means mineral matter is already produced in the first step in the soil formation process by the disintegration of different types of rocks by the different agents: physical withering, chemical withering, biological withering. These three types of withering processes are responsible for conversion of rock particles into rocks into mineral particles. So these mineral particles get mixed with organic matter. So organic matter is coming from after the death of plants and animals. The bodies of the plants and animals, they are mixed with soil. So complex organic material which is already available naturally in the bodies of the plants and animals in the form of complex organic substances like carbohydrates, fats, cellulose, lignins, etc. So these components are further broken down by the microbes and converted finally into the minerals. So this organic matter component is also important component of soil. So this inorganic component, when it is mixed with organic component by the different processes, different steps, then actual or true soil is formed. That means under the heading of soil formation, pedogenesis is the second part, which includes the mixing of organic matter into the mineral matter and true soil is formed. Then next part of this topic is composition of soil. So as far as composition of soil is concerned, so I have told you earlier in definition what is meaning of soil. Soil is the withered earth crust which is mixed with mineral matter and organic matter in which plants are growing and animals are living. So as far as composition of soil is concerned, different types of localities shows different types of soils. It depends upon the type of rocks, degree of withering and organic matter which is having in the soil. So true soil contains these components like mineral matter, soil water, soil air, soil temperature, soil humus and soil organisms. So any one of the factors about this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 factors is not available in the soil, it is not better for the growth and development of the plants. That means true soil contains these minerals, soil water, soil air, soil temperature, soil humus and soil organisms. So as far as mineral matter is concerned, major component of the soil, each and every soil, is the mineral matter. So this mineral matter is produced by the disintegration of physical, chemical, biological withering process, and depending upon the size of the mineral particles, the soil particles, depending upon their size, by considering their size, the soil particles are classified into the different categories. For example, first particle which is having about 2 mm size, these particles are commonly called as gravel. And soil which contains large amount of gravel particles is commonly called as coarse soil. Second particle size ranges from 2 to 0.2 mm. These particles are commonly called as coarse sand particles. Another kind of particles are having size 0.2 to 0.02 mm. These particles are commonly called as fine sand particles. Less type of particles are 0.22, 0.002 mm size. These particles are commonly called as silt particles. And last particles, those which are having size less than 0.002 mm, they are commonly called as clay particles. So, depending upon the further composition of different size soil particles in particular type of soils, soils are further named as coarse soil, sandy soil, then clay soil, etc. So, in this first component of composition of soil, mineral and soil texture, the texture is nothing but the structure of the soil, and this soil structure is basically depends upon the varying mixture of different sized soil particles. Soil texture plays important role in the aeration of the soil, for germination of seeds, for providing the adequate quantity of water to the plants. That means soil texture also decides the type of vegetation which is growing in particular area. Then second component is soil water. Soil water is the very important component of the soil. So water is the universal solvent. Without water, any living organism can't survive. That means water is the basic component of the protoplast. That means each and every organism is made up of different types of cells, and living cells are made up of generally cytoplasm, protoplast, living substance protoplast. So major component of the living cells, living component is the protoplast, and this protoplast contains major component as a water. So water is the universal solvent. So water plays important role in growth and development of each and every organism. It may be plant or it may be animal. So water, basically higher plants as well as lower plants take the water from soil, and it is used for metabolic activities. It is also used for transport of different types of minerals from soil to the aerial parts of the plants. That means the water plays important role. Water plays important role in the growth, development, as well as distribution of the plants, different types of vegetations. The soil water is basically divided into three categories, like hygroscopic water, capillary water, and gravitational water. So hygroscopic water is present around the soil particles in the form of thin film as a colloidal soil particles. So this capillary water is another form of water which is present in the soil particles. Soil is a porous nature, and in between the particles of the soil there is some space. It is commonly known as pores. These capillary pores of very small size are commonly called as capillary pores, and water which is retained against the gravitational force in these soil particles, in between the soil particles, is commonly called as capillary water. And last type of water which is available naturally in the soil is commonly called as gravitational water. So water which is percolated down and stops on the rock surface, it is commonly called as gravitational water. So as far as availability of water to the plant is concerned, hygroscopic water is not available for the plant. It is available in the soil, but plants are unable to absorb, root hairs of the plants are unable to absorb this hygroscopic water. Second type of water is very good quality water which is available for each and every plant. The plant may be herbaceous one, or plant may be tall trees one. This hygroscopic capillary water is mostly absorbed by the root hairs of all kinds of plants. That means capillary water is the major source of water which is available naturally in the soil, which is taken by the all crop plants, herbaceous plants, climbers, as well as woody trees also. So last type of water is commonly called as gravitational water. So I have told you earlier, the gravitational water is water which is present on the rock surface. So those plants which are having shallow root system, they are unable to absorb this water because it is present in the deeper layers of soil. Only plants which are having deep root system, that means perennial plants. This perennial plant's root system is deeper one, and it reaches up to this rock surface. And these roots of the higher plants, tall trees, perennial plants, can absorb only this gravitational water. That means as far as availability of water is concerned, water is available in soil in these three forms. Out of these three forms, capillary water and gravitational water is only available or taken by the plants and utilized for various metabolic activities, growth, development, reproduction, etc., etc. The second component of the soil is soil air. Soil air, as far as component of the soil air is concerned, as compared to aerial atmospheric air, oxygen is essential for humus formation. Oxygen is essential for each and every living organism, for cell respiration. It may be plant, it may be animal, what is essential? So as compared to aerial oxygen, soil contains less oxygen and it contains more carbon dioxide. So soil air, basically the oxygen in the soil, which is already present in the soil pores, in between the soil particles, there is a pores. In these pores, in addition to water, air is also there. That means circulation of air in the particle space takes place naturally. Steaming of the water, steaming of the air takes place naturally, and this air in the form of O2, which is essential by each and every root, for root growth, for seed germination. That means for the germination of seeds, there are three basic needs: moisture, adequate moisture, adequate temperature, and aeration. Aeration includes oxygen. If soil is lacking O2, if soil is lacking water, or soil is lacking adequate temperature, germination process stops. That means starting from germination, actual plant growth starts as far as higher plants, sexually reproducing plants. Plant growth actually starts from seed germination stage, and for the seed germination process, oxygen is essential. O2 is also essential for humus formation. So meaning of this term humus formation, the organic matter after the death of plant and animal bodies, organic matter which is present, complex organic matter present in the bodies of the plants and animals, it is decomposed by the microorganisms which are naturally available in the soil, like bacteria, some strains of the banjar. They are responsible for disintegration or degradation of this, or decomposition of this organic matter in the bodies of the plants and animals, and this substance is formed, partially decayed component, commonly called as humus. So this humus formation requires also oxygen. Oxygen in the soil is also required for nitrogen fixation. So nitrogen fixation is nothing but conversion of aerial nitrogen into nitrogenous compounds like nitrates, nitrites, etc. That means even though aerial atmospheric conditions contains near about 78% nitrogen, but plants are unable to take this aerial atmospheric nitrogen. Plant only absorb the nitrogen in the form of soluble form of nitrogen like nitrates, nitrites, ammonia, etc. So this conversion of aerial nitrogen into nitrogenous compounds like nitrates, nitrites takes place by microorganisms like bacteria, for example rhizobium, rhodomonas, as well as some algae are also there, which are coming from prokaryotic organisms, cyanophyta members like Nostoc, Arabiana, Tolipotrix, Acidotoria. There is a long list of these algae. That means algae, some members of fungi and bacteria, they are responsible for fixation of nitrogen, that means conversion of aerial nitrogen into nitrogenous compounds. So O2 is essential for nitrogen fixation. Lastly, the seed germination. I have told you earlier, seed germination process is the initial stage in the growth and development of plant. For the seed germination process also, oxygen is essential, which is provided by the soil during the process of seed germination. Then soil temperature. Temperature also plays important role in the metabolic activities of each and every living organism. Adequate temperature is essential for soil seed germination. So major source of temperature to the earth is the sun. Second source is the warm rains. Third source is the decaying organic matter. So during decaying process, temperature of soil also rises, increases. Warm rains also enhances or increases the some amount of temperature of the soil. And major source of the temperature or heat to the soil is the sun. So this soil temperature is also playing important role in the various metabolic activities of the plants, as well as germination of seeds, root growth, initiation of root hairs, etc. The next component is soil humus. So already this soil humus formation of soil humus takes place naturally by the action of microorganisms like bacteria, some fungi, on the dead and decaying organic matter which is available naturally in the bodies of the plants and animal. After the death of the plants, after the death of the animals, leaf litter, branches of leaves which are fallen on the soil surface, they are decomposed by organisms like bacteria, some fungi, and dark colored substance which is very light in weight is produced naturally in the soil. So this substance is commonly called as soil humus. So soil humus contain near about 55% carbon, 3.6% nitrogen. So out of these another components which are available in the soil, soil humus is very important component, because fertility of soil is decided by the soil humus. If soil contains more humus, soil is supposed to be more fertile. So as compared to agricultural lands, forest lands or forest soils are containing more humus, because every year there is a deposition of leaf litter on the soil in the forest area and humus formation takes place naturally. If we don't add any fertilizer in agricultural land, the production of the crop decreases because of consumption of the mineral nutrients by the roots of the plants. That's why every year farmer adds the synthetic fertilizers as well as biofertilizers or compost manures to the soil in order to maintain the fertility of soil. That means soil humus maintain the fertility of the soil, as well as it also provides food aeration, as well as it also retain more amount of water. If soil is containing more humus, water retaining ability of the soil is also enhanced. That means aeration of the soil, water holding capacity of the soil is totally depending upon soil humus. That means soil humus is a very important factor as far as plant growth is concerned. The next component in the soil is the soil organisms. So soil contains different types of organisms. They are commonly called as soil flora and soil fauna. Soil flora includes several forms of bacteria, more than 250 types of fungi, actinomycetes members, some algae members which are small in size, unicellular algae, bacteria, fungi, these includes in soil flora. Then soil fauna means animal life which is naturally available in the soil includes soil fauna. So soil fauna contains major components in the form of protozoans, nematodes, mites, insects, earthworms, etc. So each and every this organism in the form of protozoans, nematodes, mites, insects, earthworms plays an important role. For example, as far as the bacteria are concerned in the soil flora, bacteria plays an important role in the decomposition process and formation of humus. Fungi. Some fungi are also responsible for decaying process of organic matter. Some fungi also secretes some chemical substances which are commonly called as growth hormones. So these growth hormones secreted by these fungi are beneficial for growth and development of higher plant roots. That means this bacteria, fungi and many algae which are having nitrogen fixing ability, like Nostoc, Anaviana, Tolipotrix, Oscillatoria, etc., they also plays important role in enriching the soil fertility. That means soil flora plays important role in the enriching the soil fertility, as well as soil fauna also plays important role. For example, earthworms are commonly called as known as friends of the farmers. Because of burrowing habit of these animals, earthworms, soil becomes porous, as well as these earthworms excreta, which is mixed in the soil, which also enhances the soil fertility. That's why earthworms are also called as friends of the farmers. That means these mites, nematodes, insects, protozoans, earthworms, snakes, frogs, rodents, all these animals are also happily living in the soil. That means, so next part of this topic, next point of this topic is the soil profile. So meaning of this term soil profile, if we take any soil from any locality and take the section of soil, vertical section of soil, This soil shows different layers. So these different layers of soil, after taking section of soil, vertical section of soil, they are commonly called as strata. These strata or layers are formed naturally during the process of soil formation. So rocks are the parents of soils. Rocks are the parents of soil. Due to disintegration of rocks by physical, chemical and biological weathering process, soil is formed. That means thousands of years are required for the formation of soil. Thousands of years are required for formation of soil. So if we take the section of soil, vertical section of soil, soil shows different layers. These different layers are commonly called as strata or horizons. So the horizon number 1, it is commonly called as A horizon. Horizon number 2 is commonly called as B horizon. Horizon number 3 is commonly called as C horizon. And horizon number 4 is commonly called as R horizon. So if you take the vertical section of grassland soil, then these layers are observed. If we change the soil, for example, if you take the forest soil and observe the layers, observe the strata, observe the horizons, one additional layer is reported in forest soils. This is commonly named as the O horizon. So this O horizon is the layer, outermost layer of soil, which shows more component of decaying organic matter in the form of humus. Decaying organic matter in the form of humus, it is known as O horizon. So it is not shown here because it is not a cross-sectional view or vertical section of forest soil. So grassland, if we consider grassland, it shows A, B, C, D horizon, C and R horizons. So these soil horizons, or soil layers, shows different components. For example, the A horizon is also commonly called as top soil. So this top soil contains humus, organisms and roots of the small plants or herbaceous plants. The B horizon, it is containing subsoil. It contains fine particles, mineral particles, which is produced by the disintegration of rocks, leached material and some roots. Leached materials means the fine particles which are produced by the disintegration of rocks, they are leached from A horizon to B horizon by the water. That means this leached material is basically dissolved mineral salts. They are available in this second horizon. Then third horizon is commonly called as C horizon. This C horizon contains withered bedrock and some amount of leached material. So large pieces of the rock are shown here and very less amount of mineral matter is available. Organic matter is nothing in this third horizon, C horizon. Last horizon is commonly called as R horizon. This last horizon, R horizon, contains parental rock. That means these parental rocks, after disintegration, after many years, produces the apical or above layers or above horizons. So as far as the plant growth development is concerned, the top cover of the soil is very important. That means A horizon plays important role in the growth and development of the plants. Because this top soil layer, provides all essential things in the form of nutrients, water for the plants. So for the formation of 1 inch of soil, near about 200 to 800 years are required. How many years? 200 to 800 years are required for formation of top soil or fertile soil. So we should save top fertile soil. For saving the soil, top soil, we should take the measures. For soil conservation. That means due to erosion, top cover of the soil may be washed out, it may be removed and barren areas are developed. That means in the soils, different types of strata or layers are observed. If you take the vertical section of soil, and this, all these vertical in this vertical section of soil, different layers are commonly called as the soil profile. Next, part of this topic is the water cycle. So what is the universal solvent? It is a basic thing in the nature. It is required for each and every living organisms. Without water, any living organism can't survive. In our this article, water cycle, we are going to discuss the states of water in environment and water cycle. As far as states of water in the environment is concerned, in the nature, what is available in three basic forms? Solid form of water is available in the form of ice fields, snow, silt, etc. Liquid form of water is a natural water, natural form of water, which is naturally available in soil layers as well as in different water bodies, including oceans, rivers, lakes, ponds, ditches, pools, etc. That means each and every water body contains liquid form of water. Third form of water is vapor. So due to evaporation of water, due to light intensity, vapors are formed, and these vapors are mixed in the air. That means third form of water is present in the atmosphere, in the air, in the form of vapors. Then, as far as water cycle is concerned, the continuous circulation of water in the soil and atmosphere takes place, and this circulation is run by the different water bodies, plants, as well as sunlight. So sunlight is the major source of heat or energy to the planet Earth. Due to sunlight intensity, continuous evaporation of water takes place. More amount of water present on the earth is in oceans. Commonly, this water is commonly called as salty water or brackish water. So this evaporation of water in the oceans takes place, and vapors are formed, or moisture is formed, which is mixed in air. Then plants are growing happily on this soil. Different kinds of plants are there. Herbs are there, shrubs are there, trees are there, climbers are there. All kinds of plants are taking water from soil, which is available naturally in the upper layers of soil as well as deeper layers of soil also. So this soil, in this soil, the plants are growing. Plants take the water from soil, and during the process of transpiration, excessive amount of water which is present in the aerial organs of the plants, it is thrown outside in the air in the form of transpiration process, and vapors are deposited in the air. Then groundwater, that means soil layer, also contains water. Due to intensity of light, evaporation of soil, due to heating effect of sunlight, groundwater is also evaporated, and the vapors are mixed in the air. Vapors are mixed in the air, as like oceans, these lakes, small water bodies like lakes, ponds, ditches, pools, etc. Also, evaporation of water takes place continuously. When sunlight intensity is more, evaporation of water takes place in the lake. And what is converted into vapors? What is converted into vapors and mixed in the atmospheric air? So these vapors, which are produced due to evaporation of water from oceans, from lakes, and due to transpiration process, due to evaporation of water from ground or soil, the atmosphere is, if it becomes saturated with moisture, due to precipitation. Meaning of precipitation is conversion of vapors into rain. Conversion of vapors into rain is commonly called as precipitation. So precipitation is responsible for raining. So rain is the major source of water to the earth planet. After raining, water in the oceans, lakes is maintained, as well as water in the soil is also maintained by rainwater. That means total annual rainfall received by the particular geographical area throughout the world is not uniform, it is different. So the regions in the world or natural geographical areas in the world which receives higher rainfall, these regions shows evergreen plants. Those regions receives very scanty rainfall or very less rainfall, those regions which we call it as deserts. So desert region shows different kind of vegetation. Dry region plants, commonly we call these plants as the xerophytes. That means the water decides the distribution of vegetation. If rainfall is more, if water is more, every plants are growing. If water is scanty, it is less, xerobiotic plants are growing. For example, in our Rajasthan, desert area, evergreen plants are not there, tall trees are not there, vipers are not there, scrubs are there, some grasses are there, shrubs are there, but tall trees are not there. That means the distribution of vegetation, distribution of different types of plants, commonly called as phytogeography. This phytogeographical distribution or distribution of different types of plants is also decided by these two components. One is the water and another is the soil. That means soil type and availability of water in that particular area plays important role in the distribution of the plants, distribution of the plant. That means the continuous cycling of water from atmosphere to soil and from soil to atmosphere takes place naturally, continuously, and this cycling of water from atmosphere to soil and soil to atmosphere is commonly called as water cycle.